one's kind of interesting too, chapter two.
25, chapter two.
Start with, just for practice, start with number 20 on chapter two. Says a car travels north at 30 meters per second for one-half hour, and then travels south in the third. For one-half hour. So we want to actually plot displacements here. So in the first displacement, we could say that that's average velocity times time. We're going to move at 30 meters per second for one. So I want that one-half hour in terms of seconds. So have half an hour, and there's 3,600 seconds per hour. That would give. Which would be 54,000 or 54 kilometers, 4,000 meters. We go north. If I were to write that as a vector, I'd write it as a magnitude times a unit vector. That was the last thing that we talked about last time. In this case, if I were going north, that would be a J vector representing the y-axis. So I could write this vector as 54,000. A quantity in order to give it magnitude, because the unit vector just has magnitude one. What do you think about that? I mean, I didn't have to do that, this is chapter two, but I just thought I'd include that since we talked about chapter three. So anyway. Meters north. Then we're going to travel south at 40 meters per second for 15 minutes. So could call this delta y1, call this delta y2. That's going to be average velocity times time. I guess we could just go is 36,000 meters. Call this displacement B. And I can say that B is equal to 36,000 J meters. I'm going to call it negative. I'm actually going in the negative J direction. I'm going down. In terms of total distance, it would be 54,000 minus 36,000. So my total Y So I would say, ultimately, the total distance the cars traveled, or the total displacement, would be 18,000 meters north, 18 kilometers north. So my displacement displacement vector. I could say C is equal to A plus B. So that would equal 54,000 J plus a negative 36,000 J. That would represent the same thing. What about the total distance the cars traveled? What would that be? Distance would equal 54,000 plus 36,000, or 90,000 of this car. What was the average speed of this car for this whole trip? Might not be able to figure that out right off the top of your head. How would I do that though? Figure out the average speed. Speed, I would say that's the total distance divided by the total time. So that would be 90,000 meters divided by the total time, which was 45 minutes, because I had half an hour, 15 minutes, 45 minutes. Let's do this. I get 33.3 meters per second. That's kind of interesting because we moved at 30 meters per second, then we moved at 40 meters per second. Would my average speed be 35 meters per second? Halfway in between, one plus the other divided by two. gonna travel the same amount of time. Alright, no, we did not, so we just can't do things like that. So our only way to really find the average speed for a total trip like this is to figure out the total distance divided by the total time. Now the other thing I'm interested in is my average velocity. So my average velocity for this whole trip would be my total displacement, let's call it delta y, over the time, or delta t. And that would be, at least in terms of magnitude, 18,000 divided by the total time. Which would be 6.67 meters per second. Talking about velocity, I say that's north. So ultimately, I just thought this was an interesting problem because it kind of illustrates a whole lot of different things. Things we need to distinguish between is speed and velocity. Take a look at the problem right below that. Driver A is cruising along, enjoying the fall colors. Driver B starts her car at the instant he passes her. The velocities are shown as functions of time in the graph below. And what per second. We have car A, it starts at 20 meters per second and continues at 20 meters per second along this way. And we have car B that waits 2 seconds. About 60 meters per second at 8 seconds. Like that. So at 4 seconds, they're actually the question is, at what instance in time are drivers A and B side by side? What's one instance in time that they're side by side? Starts her car. That moment, so we'll say at 2 seconds, let's really start our time here at 2 seconds. They have the same position. position, same displacement, zero. All right, we would say that the, for car A, we say that our initial velocity is equal to our final velocity, is equal to our average velocity, is equal to 20 meters per second. And we could say our displacement from in the times t. What about car B? How can I describe the displacement of car B? Initial velocity would be zero. Acceleration would be, I'd have to figure that out. I need the slope of that velocity versus time graph. So if I look at the graph, we went up 20 meters per second in 2 seconds. And it's constant. So our acceleration can be 10 meters per second squared. Every second, we're going to go up 10 meters per second. So if I were to describe that displacement equals initial velocity times time, plus 1/2 acceleration times time squared, which would be 0 times time, plus 1/2 times 10, times time squared, which would be 5. That t equals 0, which used to be t equals 2, t equals 0, they're at the same position. And from that point on, we want their displacement to be the same, so we want to find the time where that occurs. So we want So we want 20t equal 5t squared. And actually, right away you can see that t equals 0 would make this work. Let's divide both sides by t. Four seconds from this moment right here. So if I were to answer this based on the graph, we would have to say on that graph it would be 2 seconds and 6 seconds. We find our 0 at 2. Incidentally, on a velocity versus time graph, their displacement is the area under. You've got the same displacement. Say if we started here, we're at the same spot, then we'd want a point, and this graph is not the best, something like this so that the area under car A, which is the area of that rectangle, the same as the area of curve B, which I could take the top of this triangle here and place it in there. It's going to be the same area. The area under a velocity versus time graph. Let's think of it this way. Velocity integrated position. That'd be the integration of velocity with respect to time. In other words, our position, our displacement, is the integration of velocity with respect to time. The integration operation is just to find the area underneath that graph. Anytime you see something versus time in calculus, when you integrate that function, you're finding the area underneath that graph. In this case, acceleration versus time, yes. That would be velocity or flat rate. It kind of goes with the formulas because for part A it was 20 times t, that's the area of a rectangle. Right? You got 20 this way, and t is just whatever you're going that way. So it's rise times run, or it's, you know, a times b. And for the height, the base being height being a times t, and the base being t, and 1/2. So that's the area of a triangle, 1/2 the base times the height. Height being a t, base being t. Okay. Let's try it out. These open-ended problems. Meters per second is bounced off a brick wall and rebounds at 22 meters per second. The high-speed camera records this event. If the ball is in contact with the wall for 3.5 milliseconds, what is the average acceleration of the ball during this time interval? We could use the definition of acceleration to do this, but I really don't want to get too far away from those Kinmack equations. So let's try a Kinmack equation on this one. All right, so we have a super ball traveling and here's our super ball traveling like this. And what do we know about it? Initial velocity is 25 meters per second. And that's the final velocity, and we'll assume that that's the velocity it's going to continue with after rebound from the wall. What is that final velocity? 22 meters per second. We'll call this a negative 22 meters per second. All right, good. And we're kind of worried about what the acceleration is when he hits the wall. We'll assume that's a constant acceleration because I promised you that we won't do anything but constant acceleration. -3 seconds. So let's look at this event that's happening at the wall. We know the initial velocity, we know the final velocity, we know the time, and we want to know acceleration. Based on that, which velocity equals initial velocity plus acceleration times time. Solve this for acceleration. So we have acceleration equals final velocity minus initial velocity divided by time. Write this as negative 22 for the final velocity minus negative 47 divided by all this. Negative 13,429. The negative just has to do with the way that we set the problem. If we had put the brick wall to the left and thrown our super ball to the left, our positive 13,429 meters per second squared. So at least in either case, we have the magnitude of that velocity for that timing, or that acceleration for that timing. Pretty large acceleration. A speedy tortoise can run with a velocity of 10 centimeters per second, and a hare can run 20 times as fast. In a race, they both start at the same time, but the hare stops to rest for two minutes. The tortoise wins by a shell. What was the length of the race? Alright, so we have a tortoise. Is 10 centimeters per second, 0.1 meters per second. And we have a hare. That's the best I can draw. both start at the same time. The hare stops to rest for 2 minutes. The tortoise wins by a shell. All right, so here's t equals zero. And sometime later, displacement for the tortoise is this whole displacement. What we can say, at least then, is that the displacement of the tortoise is equal to the displacement of the hare plus the length of the tortoise. The tortoise won by the shell, 20 centimeters. Describe the motion of the tortoise in terms of, well, what do we know? What do we know about the tortoise in terms of kinematic variables? So if I were to describe the displacement of the tortoise, what equation would I use, do you think? I probably have a few choices. Zero, right? The velocity is constant. So the tortoise does not change velocity. So the tortoise has an acceleration of zero. So if I want to describe the displacement of the tortoise, let's say if I used equation number two, initial plus final divided by two times time, which would be 0.1. Plus 0.1 divided by 2 times time, which is just 0.1 times time. It's just one way to look at it. That would describe the displacement of the tortoise. Initial velocity times time plus 1/2 acceleration times time squared, I would realize that the tortoise has no acceleration. So that would just be initial velocity times time, which is 0.5 in the displacement of the tortoise. What about the hair? What can I say about the hair? I might want to change this equation right here. Second. Depending on how we want to look at it. Let's say that when we're talking right. In other words, the time for the hare is going to be shorter than the time for the tortoise. So really, I should have put minus 120 seconds here. Right? Because the hare is actually only going to be moving for time for the hare would be the time for the tortoise minus 2 minutes. It's shorter. So if I think of that time, whatever time that the hare is moving, for this shorter time, displacement for the hare would be average velocity times time, which would be 2. Times the time for the hare. What should I do next? Exactly. Let's go to this equation and plug in for these displacements. So we have displacement for the tortoise equals displacement for the hare plus the shell length. And displacement for the tortoise is minus 240 plus 0.2. Let's solve this for t. So we have, over here will be 240 minus 0.2 equals 2t. Two one seconds. We want to find the length of the race. The length of the race point 1 times 126 and 21 seconds. Which would be 12.6. Kind of makes sense, because the hair stopped for 2 minutes. The hair moves at 2 meters per second. So if you think of the hair, if the hair were just to run this race flat out, a little bit more than 6 seconds. But the hair decided to stop for 2 minutes, 120 seconds. So the hair almost did the whole race, and it took the hair 126, a little bit more than 126 seconds. Of the hair. Feel better or worse than you did on the first finger? All right, let's try a nice straightforward problem here. Can we do Chris, can we say we have? We did that one. Let's do it again. Stone is thrown from the top of the building with initial velocity of 20 meters per second. Downward, top of the building is 60 meters above the ground. How much time elapses between the instant of release and the instant of impact on the ground? Should I do? Anything in the direction of my initial velocity is defined to be positive. So if I could say my initial velocity is positive this way, that makes that positive. That and the thing we were asked for, I say my final velocity is zero? No. Why not? Constant acceleration intervals. Okay. So let's try this one. So I want to use kinematic equation number 4 on this one. So delta y will equal initial velocity times time. Let's set that up. So we have 60 is equal to 20 times time plus 1/2 times 9.8 times time squared. All those quantities, all those variables were positive. So put them in exactly as their values are. By 6 card that you're allowed. I did tell you you're allowed a 4-mil card, right? 4 by 6 card, so you might want to have a quadratic formula. And so in this case, t would be to negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared times 4ac. So negative 20 plus or minus square root of 1576 over 9.8. That's a negative 20. Plus or minus 40. If I add the two, so negative 20 plus that, divide that by 9.8. Get 2.01 seconds. I get a negative 6.09 seconds. Almost there. I almost got it perfected in the lab there. I just need need a few more volunteers. Because of square root, mathematically, yeah. I mean, if you have a quadratic formula, you're always going to get two answers, right? But on the other side of that question, intuitively, why did we get a negative answer? Is there a physical significance? That's one reason why I kept that answer in there. Let's think about the criteria for this problem. We threw it down at 20 meters per second with gravity. Down to that point. All right? So we wanted to find the time it took for that ball to get there, which was, as we found, 2.01 seconds to get there. But under the criteria of that problem, it's just as equivalent to say that if we had taken this meters per second there would be the same as if we had thrown it, but if it had just been falling and past that point at 20 meters per second. If we took it back in time so that we went up to maximum height back this way and then came all the way back down to the point at which it would be at ground level, that would have been 6.0. Right. In other words, it would have fit the criteria of the problem, which meant the ball would have been at the same displacement, which would be at the ground. But it has a physical significance. That would have been, so in other words, right. You would throw it from the ground. So there is a reason that you come up with two answers there, at least a physical reason. After saying that, if you're not one for quadratic formulas, there's a different way that you could approach this problem. What was that? You know, sometimes, you know, you could try to find more information on the problem. In other words, I'm doing a kinematic problem. There are five variables. They're asking for time, which is forcing me to use this formula, which is a quadratic formula. I put in all the values. What I could have done, I could have said, well, let's find the final velocity. Three variables and that one to find the final velocity. So let's say that from kinematic equation number three, final velocity equals initial velocity, final velocity squared equals initial velocity squared plus two times acceleration delta y. Acceleration delta y, which would be 20 squared plus 2 times 9.8 times 60, which would be the square root of 1576, which would be 39.7. Now I could say, okay, now I know the final velocity. Initial velocity was 20, acceleration was 9.8, So using kinematic equation number one, velocity equals initial velocity plus acceleration times time. Solve this for time. Times 20, divided by 9.8, 19.7 divided by 9.8, 2.01 seconds. Quadratic formula was coming out. It's straightforward. Straightforward work. And also another way to check. Now, if I finished the test and I just had too much time on my hands, it's one way to check my answer. Look at the chapter 3 handout. And before I do problem number 4, let's look at problem number 1. Problem number one, vectors A and B are shown. What is the magnitude of vector C? C is equal to 2. Looks something like that. Vector C, the magnitude of vector C, if C what can I do about something like this? Go on to problem number 2. What I need to do is find a coordinate system to put these vectors in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put up a Cartesian coordinate system. I'm actually going to this. So I'm going to kind of redo this, something like this. So B is along the x-axis. Magnitude of A is still 40, magnitude of B is 50. The axis. I can write my vector B as a magnitude times a unit vector. So I write B as being equal to 50 times I. That's totally in the x direction. I is a unit vector that defines that direction. 50 is my magnitude. Y direction. If I look at it, I've got a vector that has magnitude 40 and an angle 60 degrees. So I have two components. I got an A sub X component and an A sub Y component. If I were to write vector A in terms of this, I could say A is equal to A sub X vector plus A sub Y vector. these two vectors add tip to tail. A sub x, is it totally in the x direction? Its magnitude, if I look at this triangle, the magnitude of a sub x would be what? Cosine 60, I. For that matter, the magnitude of a sub y would be magnitude of a sub y?
40 sine 40.
So I have to give that a j. Let's actually figure out numbers for these magnitudes. So 40 times cosine of 60. That's 20i, and then sine of 60 times 40. So I have two vectors, 50i, and I have a 20i plus 34.64j. We want to find a vector C that's equal to A minus B. Mathematically, I could write this like this. Put A, which is 20i, which is 34.64j, and subtract B, which is 50i. Now, what is either positive or negative? All right, so you can add or subtract those just like they were scalars. And once you're in the same direction, same linear direction with something, you can just add them or subtract them. You don't have to worry about that they're at an angle. So, in terms of this, my 20i is 30i. And the other term is unmatched. 34.64j plus 0 is 34.64j or minus 0. So there's our vector. That represents plus 34.64 this way. And that would be vector C. C is equal to A minus B. If I were to add the two, I would add them tip to tail like that, and B would go out this way, and it's A plus B. Well, I could write A minus B as A plus a negative B. So have a negative B is a vector that has the same magnitude, 180 degrees opposite direction. Alright, let me try it over this way. Just to make it more clear. I would say A plus tip to tail negative B gives me see. A plus negative B. Take a look at number four. Does that make sense? Here's C, right? C is represented by two. So to find the magnitude of a vector, you would square every component, add them together, take the square root like the diagram there. And whether it's two dimensions or three dimensions, it doesn't matter. I would take this component square plus this component square, add them together, take the square root, get the magnitude of the vector. So the magnitude of C B is subtracted from A, the result is negative 4i plus 7j. What is the magnitude of A? Let's write vector A out in terms of I and J. Let's say A is equal to sum A sub X I plus A sub Y J. We don't know what those two coefficients are, but they represent magnitudes. They could be positive or negative as well. And do the same thing for B. So we'll say B to those unit vectors, positive or negative as well. It says if vector B is added to vector A, the result is 6i plus j. So if we did A plus B, as we add is negative 4i plus j. comes back to A. You know what? This is a lot easier than I've set it up here. So we really don't even have to look at this part. Just look at this. If I added this to this, I'd have 2a plus 0. That'd be 2a. And I'd have to do the same over here. So I'm going to add this to this. Because if this equals this and that equals that, add this down. So we'll have 2i plus 8j. A is equal to I plus 4J. And the magnitude of A is 17. Should be 4.4 something. 1.23. Sure. Plus A minus B. So A plus A is 2A. B plus negative B is 0.
Okay, and then where
did you get
the
over here, I added 6i plus 4j, give me 2i, and j plus 7j is 8j. Fun? I do want to introduce something new today, at least if you're thinking about it. Too much light? Is that good enough? All right, Dale, what do I do? Thank you. there's a reason why we did chapter 3 to introduce vectors, and that's so that we can expand. Most likely, most of your problems are going to be two-dimensional problems. That is the purpose of this chapter. So we're going to identify the motion variables in three-dimensional form, identify the general equations that we need to look at motion in two dimensions or three dimensions, solve. Tangential and radial acceleration and their relationship. This might be something I might wait until after this first test for that last one. Yes?
Did we finish chapter 3 today?
We kind of did with my example today. Yeah, it doesn't make sense to talk about two-dimensional motion unless you feel comfortable about that. So let's talk a little bit more about this IJK thing. One of the things we talked about introducing vectors is that we said that if you were to multiply a vector by a scalar, essentially, if you multiply a vector by a scalar number, you get a vector that has the same direction, but it's just has a greater magnitude by that factor, by that scalar. Right? So if I have two times the vector, I get a vector that's twice as long. Come up with something that is mathematically feasible. So what we've done, not me particularly, but we have a three-dimensional coordinate system where we say that we're just going to define a direction in the x direction as I. So if I wanted to define a vector in particular in the x direction, I could take this magnitude 1 little vector I and multiply it by a number, any number to give it magnitude. So for instance, if I wanted a vector that was length 5 meters or 5, then I were to say that my vector I multiply by a scalar, give it magnitude. Well, I could do the same thing in the j direction. Here's a y direction. I designate that by unit vector j, magnitude 1. Magnitude 6 in the j direction. I would multiply this unit vector by 6, and I would get a vector. I'll call a sub y, and that in this case would be equal to 6j, the magnitude times the unit vector. That gives me some that you can add vectors tip to tail to come up with a third vector. We had a plus b plus c. Wherever you started to wherever you ended would be your resultant vector. And if I could go A plus B, I add them tip to tail, I get A plus B. Well, I'm going to do that with A sub X and A sub Y. Know something like that. That's the same as if I had started here and gone to here. In other words, in vector sense, I could write this. And it's simply adding these two, what I call component vectors, together, tip to tail, gives me this third vector. But what are those component vectors? The way I define here is 5i, this was 6j. So I can write this as 5i. So far. But I could actually even go three dimensions. Right? If I want to come out towards you, I don't have to stay in the x. Because I have AX, AY, I just need AZ out this way. It could be any scalar number times the unit vector in that direction, which is k. Right, so we have a ij, k. So let's say I have an az, which I'm going to kind of write along this direction. Incidentally, unit vectors are all given little hats, right? And vectors themselves are given arrows. The hat just means it's a unit vector. So I could actually have an A that comes out would give me a vector that started here and got to there. That takes a little bit of imagination. Most of the vectors that we're going to deal with are only going to be two-dimensional. It'll be, you know, be I and J. But you can imagine that there's possibility that's it. I mean, that's really vectors in a nutshell. But let's try something here. is like this. Let's say my magnitude in the x direction of this is 3. And my magnitude in the y direction is 4. First of all, how would I write that? Here is 3i plus 4j. Let's say I had another vector. Four in the x direction. I minus 2j. Correct. Suppose I want to add a plus b. I want to add these two vectors. Vector a. B is 4i. Minus 2j. So I can imagine I'm going to have to go out this way a little bit. I have to go out this way, 4i minus 2j. If I add a plus b, the resultant would be this factor. Call it R. Let's say R is equal to A plus B. Right. What is that value? Work this out. This would be 3i plus 4j. Plus 4i minus 2j. I can add all the i's together because they're in the same direction. Right? Even though they're in an opposite direction, you can't. All the i's can add or subtract. All the j's can add or subtract. And that's the beauty of putting a vector in this kind of i, j, k form. So, 3i plus 4i is 7i. Equal to 7i plus 2j. Now, if I look at this, that's exactly what it is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 7, 7i plus 2j. So I have this r component, r sub x is 7i, and r sub y, which is 2j, and that plus that. Let's try r, let's try another one, let's say a minus b. Call it C. C is equal to A minus B. Minus B, which is 4i minus 2j. Gives me what? Minus I J minus I plus 6j. Is C equal to A minus B? What would happen if I did that graphically? I'll finish up here. If I took A minus B, here's B. Minus B, we define as being I would go A plus a negative B, and I'd end up here. Which happens to be a negative I plus 6j. Try your hand at more of these chapter 3 problems.